Hello and welcome to the course of History of India, and we are covering the entire history via wall chart. Okay, so as we all know that history is a very, very important topic for UPSC, but it becomes difficult at times to actually cover the entire history because it is so vast and wide. So here we are at Plus Prameshi Library, and you can also visit the website to buy this particular chart, or you can visit to Amazon or Flipkart. So here you will get the entire history starting from the ancient times till the modern times in just one wall chart. So I know it will actually ease the preparation for you, and it will be helpful for you for revision of entire history in just one go. So this is something about me, Supriya Singhal. I'll be the mentor for this course, who will be taking this wall chart discussion with you. We have already covered the ancient history in three videos only, and now we are coming with the fourth video to cover the medieval Indian history. Okay, this is the wall chart, and here I have been telling you, and I'll just repeat it one more time. Please, it's a request that whatever things that you might have learned in art and culture, or something else that you feel that this chart is important to you and it is not mentioned in the chart, you can also have sticky notes with you and you can stick on this chart. So I will rather say that this is like a one-stop solution for entire history for you, and you can modify it according to whatever you need. So we'll start with the medieval India. So we already ended at the time when we saw basically two things. Okay, we covered South Indian kingdoms also, and we covered North Indian kingdoms also. Okay, the last major ruler that we can think of in the North Indian Empire was basically Harsha, or from the Harshvardhan Empire. Okay. Or Pushyabhuti dynasty. So Harsha was probably the last king that we know. And then in the southern India, we went on to basically discuss the Pallavas and Chalukyas also. Okay, so now we will start with the medieval India. So medieval India generally is said to be that time, or you can also call it at that time, when you will find here the lot of invasions happening from the northwestern side of India. Okay, and here you will find the dynasties, like there are invasions happening, there are foreign people coming, and then finally they are actually settling down in India, and then you know making like great empires. So here if I have to divide medieval India, I will divide it into two parts. One is the Delhi Sultanate, another is the Mughal Empire. But apart from it, there are like some fringe elements also, which includes Bahamani kingdoms, which include Kingdom of Khandesh, for example, Kingdom of Gujarat, then also includes King Vijayanagar Empire. Okay, Vijayanagar Empire is a very, very important topic for an art and culture perspective point of view also, because you already know that Vijayanagar Empire's the capital was at Hampi, and the monuments at Hampi are also included in the World Heritage Sites. So that is why you will find that from art and culture perspective, Vijayanagar Empire is also very important. Okay, so now we will start with the Delhi Sultanate. Okay, so you know that last time what was happening was first Mahmud of Ghazni, okay, he invaded India, and after him came Muhammad Ghori. Okay, and with Ghori we know basically Prithviraj Chauhan had two battles. Okay, Battle of Tarain 1 and Battle of Tarain 2 in 1191 and 1192 AD. Okay, so after this what happened, when Prithviraj Chauhan lost the battle in 1192, okay, Muhammad Ghori actually you can say that got an oversight over India. And then he appointed, like after his death, you will find that one of his slaves established the slave dynasty in India, which becomes the starting point for medieval India. Okay, so I'm just linking the ancient history part to the medieval India right now. And now we will start with the exact what happens in ancient medieval India, and then who all becomes a ruler. Okay, so in Delhi Sultanate, which we are discussing, see, first of all, in medieval India, Delhi Sultanate will be there, and after Delhi Sultanate, there will be Mughal Empire. But having said that, you should know that Delhi Sultanate is not just one dynasty. There were five, you can say, different dynasties that ruled over this period, starting from somewhere around 1206 and going till 1526. Okay, when Babur came to India, before that. Okay, and because Babur was the first Mughal emperor who ruled India. So in Delhi Sultanate, you have five dynasties. You have slave dynasty. Okay, then you have Khiljis. Then you have Tughlaqs, then you have Sayyids, and finally you have Lodis. And it is the last Lodi ruler, which is basically the last Lodi ruler, which you will find is actually defeated by Babur in the battle. And hence you will see Delhi Sultanate getting replaced by the Mughal Empire. So, having said that, we will now look at each of these dynasties and their important rulers. But before that, it's my duty to actually give you a short overview as to how many kings we actually need to know from each of these dynasties. Otherwise, it will become very impossible for us to remember so much of history. So, in slave dynasty, majorly, you have to remember four rulers. Okay, the first, the starting ruler, okay, who was basically Qutbuddin Aibak. Then, after him, you have to remember Iltutmish. Then Iltutmish's daughter Razia Sultan, okay, who could rule only for very short span of time, like 4 years. And after Razia, the last one, Balban. Okay, so these four rulers, they all belong to slave dynasty. After slave dynasty, within Delhi Sultanate only, there was Khiljis. In Khiljis, you have to remember two, Jalaluddin Khilji and Alauddin Khilji. Yes, he's the same Alauddin Khilji, of which basically you might have heard there was a novel written by Muhammad Malik Jaisi called as Padmavati, right? Padmavati. And in that novel, it was written how basically in the Chittor fort, there was a Johar performed. Okay, so it's the same Alauddin Khilji. Then after Khilji dynasty, you have Tughlaqs. Okay, in Tughlaqs, you have Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, then you have Firoz Shah Tughlaq, and then you have one more Tughlaq, okay, which Muhammad bin Tughlaq, which we'll study when we are coming in the medieval India section. Then in Sayyids, you don't have to remember particularly the Sayyids because their contribution and their rule both were very less. But their contribution with respect to the art and culture section is important because they were the ones to introduce few things in art and culture section. Okay, and then comes the last, which is basically the Lodis. In Lodis, you have Sikandar Lodi, Ibrahim Lodi. Okay, so here I gave you a short overview as to what is happening, because otherwise what will happen once we start with events, it will become difficult for you to actually, you know, gauge what is happening, which dynasty is where. So now I think you've gotten an overview. So let's just start. So the first ruler of medieval India that we will be studying is under the Delhi Sultanate, is also under the slave dynasty, which is under Delhi Sultanate. And under slave dynasty, we are studying the first ruler whose rules established in 1206. And it was basically Qutbuddin Aibak. Okay, so this Qutbuddin is not the reason behind establishment of Qutb Minar. Okay, Qutb Minar was established to actually, you will find that there was a Sufi saint, okay, Qutbuddin Bakhtiar. It was in his honor that Qutb Minar was built. So generally, I think this was asked in one of the state civil services examination as to Qutb Minar basically is referring to Qutbuddin Aibak, which is wrong. Okay, so you should remember 1206 to 1290 is the slave dynasty. Entire slave dynasty is 1206 to 1290. And here the starting is with Qutbuddin Aibak, who establishes the slave dynasty. Before we move forward, you should know that slave dynasty is also called as the Mamluk dynasty. Please, it's important you write it here itself. Slave dynasty is also called as the Mamluk dynasty. Okay. And it is also called as the Qutbi dynasty because it was established by the Qutbuddin Aibak. Then after Qutbuddin Aibak, okay, you will find that only 4 years Qutbuddin Aibak could rule. And after his death, basically, there was a reign of Iltutmish, who became the second ruler. So Iltutmish reign is very, very important. If you study in detail about medieval India, which we will be covering anyways, another course which we have taken in which we are covering entire medieval India. Okay, so you will find that Iltutmish was the one who was very... you can say able ruler. He was able to actually, avoid Mongolian invasions because, he was able to keep them at bay. He did not go into war with Mongolians. And then you will realize that he was a very able ruler. Okay, he started many things like Chalisi. Okay, he also had a Bandarga. So these are what? So these are basically ways to control an empire. He basically started forming a very small council of 40 slaves or 40 people who could keep an eye on the affairs of the administration. Okay, so that is why you will find that Iltutmish administration is actually very, very important. So he, Iltutmish, ruled after Qutbuddin Aibak for almost, you can say, somewhere around 25 years from 1211 to 1236 AD. Okay. But then, as I've told you, that Iltutmish was able to actually save the empire from the Mongol invasions, which were very dreadful. And Mongols were actually invading under Chinggis Khan. And this Chinggis Khan is very, very popular. I mean, just like we say, Babbar aa jayega, right? So people actually used to say, Chinggis Khan aa jayega. It was that, people were that fearful of Mongol invasions. Okay. Now, after Iltutmish's death, you will realize that there was a gap and there was a lot of, lot of chaos in the administration. But finally, who took the reign was the female and her name was Razia Sultan. So Razia Sultan, there was a movie also made, and I don't know if you have watched it or not. So Razia Sultan, you will find that obviously since she is a female also, so there are a lot of conspiracies going around in the empire to actually get her removed from the throne. And finally, you know, she actually dies because of one of the conspiracy. And she was able to rule only for 4 years. So first comes the Qutbuddin Aibak, second comes the Iltutmish, and third comes the Razia Sultan, who is the daughter of Iltutmish. Okay, finally, you will find that there is a succession war going on here, if you can see. Okay, till here. So almost you will find till 20-25 years, there is no one particular ruler that is ruling. There are rulers who are changing again and again. And finally, you will find in around 1266, basically, there is a reign of Ghiyasuddin Balban. Okay, and his reign, as you can see here, is quite a 20 to 25 year long reign, where you will find that there is a lot of stability in the empire, because Balban, he knew that, you know, he did not want to give up the empire he has got after so much of mehnat, okay, like so much of hard work, and he made sure that no two people could conspire against him. That is why you will realize that he actually, you know, stopped all the festivals. He also introduced the system of sajda and you know, pabos, wherein basically it's like a Persian system, wherein, you know, the people who are coming to the king, they have to touch the king's feet, etc. They have to kiss the king's feet. So systems like that to ensure that, you know, they all remember that finally king is the one who is like the ruler is the one who is the powerful here. So to make sure that people or the nobles do not consider themselves you know, above the king or above the ruler. So after Balban, again you will find there was some anarchy until 1290. You can say finally there was the end of slave dynasty. So here what we have done is, within Delhi Sultanate, we have covered slave dynasty, starting from Qutbuddin Aibak, then Iltutmish, then we have Razia Sultan, and finally we have Balban. Okay, now we move to the second dynasty within the Delhi Sultanate, which is basically Khiljis. Okay, in Khiljis, as I told you, the two names that you need to remember is Jalaluddin Khilji and Alauddin Khilji. And if you have watched that movie called Padmavat, which also gained a lot of controversy, but keeping that fact aside, if you watch these movies, it's easier for you to remember things. Okay, I mean, right now is not the time to leave your prelims and watch the movies, but if you do get a chance, always watch these historic movies. Okay, it's very, very important, because you get to remember the history. Otherwise, it's really difficult to remember the names and the years and the contemporaries. But if you have watched these movies, it's become really, really easy. For example, recently there was a controversy regarding a movie called Panipat, okay, in which you already know there were three stars, Arjun Kapoor, then Kirti Sanon and Sanjay Dutt. And here you might have heard that, you know, in Rajasthan, this movie faced a lot of trouble because they showed Raja Surajmal in bad light. Okay, so now after reading this, actually it becomes important for you for prelims to study about Raja Surajmal and the state of Bharatpur, the Jat state of Bharatpur, what all districts today it covers, okay, who was contemporary of Raja Surajmal, or what was the role played by Raja Surajmal in the war which was happening between Ahmad Shah Abdali and the Mughal emperor, and why were Marathas fighting from the Mughal side. So all these things will come together once we study the modern Indian history. But having said that, you need to remember at least what is going on, you know, in the news. The people who are getting in the news, people who are becoming controversial, the historical figures that are again and again coming. Okay, that way you can actually anticipate at least 2 or 3 questions also. So now we will come to Khilji's part. So Khilji's, as you would have seen, basically it starts from 1290. Okay, so from 1290 you will realize that it goes till 1320. So somewhere it's not a very big rule, around 30-32 years of rule is there of Khilji's, and the establishment is done by Jalaluddin Khilji, as I told you, in 1290, just after, you can say, Delhi Sultanate. Then you will find that Alauddin Khilji was not the son of Jalaluddin Khilji, and I know that this question was asked in one of the state civil services examination and people got it wrong. So basically Jalaluddin Khilji was the uncle of Alauddin Khilji, chacha or someone, okay, he was not the father of Alauddin Khilji. So now in 1296 you will realize, because this 1290 to 96, 6 years rule there was there of Jalaluddin Khilji, but in 1296 Alauddin Khilji actually invades Devagiri and finally he becomes the Sultan. Okay, and after Alauddin takes the throne, he actually wants to expand the empire. And for this, you know, he's not just actually conquering territories. He's not only, you know, going to wars with different, especially the Rajputana states, but he's also making sure his administration is efficient. So whenever we study medieval India separately in a different course, you will realize that Alauddin Khilji actually did a lot of administrative reforms. Okay, for example, he introduced a system of spy to check if the markets were performing well. Then he had four different markets for horses, for slaves, for all these regular commodities, and then agriculture produce. Okay, then thirdly, he also introduced basically a proper system for land measurement so that he can get a better land revenue. Okay, so just like that, you will realize he had lot of reforms done to ensure that, you know, state is always full of treasury. Okay, apart from the administrative reforms, if you know that Alauddin Khilji was actually infamous among the Rajputana states because it is said that he was the reason for many Jauhars. Okay, one Jauhar that was committed in Ranthambore, another which was committed in Chittor. Okay, so these two Jauhars have quite recently been in news also, so you should know about it. But otherwise, you will know that Alauddin Khilji actually invaded Gujarat. Then on the way, he had Ranthambore and Chittor. And then you will find that he also invaded Malwa, Ujjain, Mandu and Chanderi like states. Okay. And he also took, but one part you should remember or what is criticized about Alauddin Khilji was a southern campaign under Malik Kafur. Okay. And this Malik Kafur is very beautifully explained if you actually go and watch the movie Padmavat. Okay. And finally, you will realize that in 1320, there is this end of Khilji dynasty. So Khiljis are under Delhi Sultanate, which are coming after slave dynasty because you have Khiljis. After Khiljis, you will find there is a starting of Tughlaqs. Okay, so Tughlaq dynasties are coming. Now in Tughlaq, you have how many rulers? Three rulers. You have Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, you have Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and you have Firoz Shah Tughlaq. So in 1320, for 5 years only, you will find that Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, who is the founder of Tughlaq dynasty, he actually starts the empire, like Tughlaq empire. And he actually goes for wars in both Deccan side also and in Bengal side also. After him, after Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, was the reign of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Okay, Muhammad bin Tughlaq is also called as the Mad King. And this is because he took lot of decisions which actually failed. And a lot of time, historians, instead of criticizing him, they have said that his reforms were way ahead of time. Okay, at that time, these reforms were not needed. For example, he actually started the concept of token currency, what we see today. So the 5 rupees coin or the 10 rupees coin, if you see the 5 rupees coin, it has basically gold plating and you feel like it's a gold coin. But no, it's not a gold coin. Okay, so that is what basically you are trying to show something which is not. Okay, this is called as a token currency. Suppose now if you issue lead coins, but you say that those lead coins value will be same as silver coin, then you call it as a token currency. Basically, you are giving a token in lieu of something. So he was the one who started with token currency, the idea of token currency, but it actually failed because people started, forging it. Okay, and there was a lot of fake currency in the market. So his idea failed. Similarly, you will find that he started giving takkavi loans to these agricultural farmers so that they could actually take loans and start investing in the agriculture for more better technologies. And hence, there will be more cultivation and more revenue will come to the state. But these also failed because a lot of farmers defaulted on the loans. So another one of the, infamous policies was that he actually thought that he could conquer South. And he wanted to shift his capital. I'm not saying he wanted to conquer South. I'm saying he wanted to shift his capital from the main center Delhi and taking it to Daulatabad in the South. And which became a point of contention. Because what happened was, he actually, during the shift of his territory, he left, there was a lot of expenses involved to take that entire army and then, shift it to Daulatabad. And secondly, you will find that this led to lots of problems also, and this left Delhi to the foreign invasions also. Okay, so here you will find that Muhammad bin Tughlaq, okay, can be said to be infamous king, but he is also said to be a famous king which tried to introduce reforms, but they did not work. So after Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, you had Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Okay, then he ruled for almost 25 years, and you will find that there was a very famous ambassador, or you can say a traveler, called as Ibn Battuta. And just like I was telling you, there were Chinese travelers. Okay, on which already the question was asked in mains. In the same question in 2018 mains, you will realize they also asked you about the Arab travelers. So there you had to mention about the Ibn Battuta, Al-Biruni, and these people who came with different, kings or rulers. So Ibn Battuta was the African traveler, and he traveled a lot, okay, throughout the world. So basically he was from Morocco, And he traveled like Morocco, Egypt, Tunisia, and then he went to certain Turkey, etc., and then Saudi, etc., and then he came to India. So he traveled a lot on foot, and his accounts basically are very, very important to understand what was happening in the society and economy then. Okay, then after that, you will find once Muhammad bin Tughlaq's reign is over, then comes the Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Okay, so his reign is starts from around 1351, and later, obviously, I am just telling you the three main important rulers. It's not like the ruler died and the dynasty finishes. No, after him some weak rulers might have come, but then there might be invasions happening, and that is why they are not and they might have not done anything significant that we need to remember. So hence we are not remembering them specifically from the point of view of examination, not from the point of view of history. Okay, and you should just remember one thing, that during Tughlaq's there was an invasion of Timurs that had happened. And why Timurs are important, that you will come to know when we study Mughal rule. Okay, so after Tughlaq's, as I mentioned you, so we have studied three: slave, we have Khiljis, and we have Tughlaq's. Now the fourth dynasty that we will be studying is the Sayyid dynasty. Okay, these Sayyids, we will find they have ruled for a very short period of time, around 30-35 years. And here there was one ruler called Khizir Khan, then there was Mubarak Khan, and then there was Muhammad Shah. But you don't need to remember these rulers, because there is nothing significant, any battle that you need to remember. But in Sayyids, you just need to remember one name, which is Khizir Khan, which you can say to be the founder of this Sayyid dynasty. Okay, after Sayyids came the Lodis, and in Lodis you need to remember three names. First is the person who established the Lodi dynasty, who was the Behlul Lodi. Then after him came the Sikandar Lodi, and then after him came the Ibrahim Lodi. It's the same Ibrahim Lodi who had to fight the war with Babur, and he lost the war. It was the first battle of Panipat. He lost the war, and finally you will find the Delhi Sultanate comes to an end, and there starts the Mughal Empire. Okay, so 1450 to 1526, this 1526 you need to remember. So there are few dates that you need to remember. Okay, one is 1206, then another is 1526, then there is 1576. Okay, and after that you will realize 1707, and after that. Okay, so why are these dates important? Because 1206 is the time when Delhi Sultanate gets established, like first dynasty, slave dynasty gets established. 1526 is when Delhi Sultanate is getting over, and your Mughal Empire is getting started. Okay, 1576 is the time when Battle of Haldighati is fought. Okay, it's the same battle where the Shoorveer Maharana Pratap actually fought with the very large army of Akbar, which was also supported by then King of Amer, Man Singh. And then the war took place in the famous Battle of Haldighati, and it was called as the inconclusive battle. Okay, and 1707 we will study later, and how is it related to Aurangzeb. Okay, so these few dates that you need to remember, years, because they are specifically as in here and there in banking or state services examination. Okay, so Lodis, their rule starts from 1450, goes on till 1526. First is Behlul Lodi, then is Sikandar Lodi, and then we have Ibrahim Lodi, who is the one to fight the Battle of Panipat. Now, after covering Delhi Sultanate, we'll first cover like few here and there smaller states and provincial kingdoms, like that of Gujarat, then Khandesh, and then Malwa. Okay, Makalwa or Malwa. So the first one we have is basically Gujarat, and this was established by the Nasiruddin Muhammad Shah. And you will realize that he founded the city of Ahmedabad. And I don't know if you notice it, but Ahmedabad, the old city, has been included in the World Heritage Site list also, which is given by UNESCO, the old city. Okay, and if you know the I Am Ahmedabad logo, you will realize that this logo has a lot to do with this old city, and specifically to this particular empire. Okay, provincial kingdom. So now this link you have to tell me, because it's a current affairs related news. Okay, then you will realize that in 1510, actually the point is, in medieval and modern India, we have described it, or we have demarcated it according to the Indian rulers and kings. Okay, we have not demarcated it as such according to European happenings going on, because in Europe at this particular time, 14th-15th century or 16th century, you will find there is a this is called as the era of Renaissance, Reformation, and then comes the Industrial Revolution. So in Europe there are a lot of things that are happening that are actually changing people's thoughts, people's experiences, okay, their way of living, their culture, their education, everything. Okay, and that is why this period is called as the modern, because here people will start realizing the ideas of liberty, equality, okay, and freedom. So these ideas have come in Europe much earlier, and later on they will come in India. Okay, so having said that, probably you might see that in European empire the modern era starts pretty much little earlier, but in India, once we basically say modern era starts after Mughal empire, specifically after Aurangzeb, because after Aurangzeb you consider that there is no particular single Mughal ruler who is able to maintain such vast empire in a very significant way. And that is when you will find that most of these foreign companies have now started invading in India's personal matters. Okay, so 1510, although I know there has been a European entry by now, okay, but still we don't call it as a modern era. We include it, we include this particular thing in the medieval Indian history only. Okay, because this is this I have seen some confusion with a lot of people, so hence I thought I'll just clarify it. So 1510 you will find that there is occupation of Goa by Portuguese, and in 1526 to 37 you will find that Sultan Bahadur Shah was killed by the Portuguese. Okay, and here also you will find that there is a battle that you need to study once we go to the modern Indian section, because there you will study most about Portuguese. Then comes the Farooqi Kingdom of Khandesh, and it starts from 1390 and goes on till 1601, so roughly about 300 years. Now you must be thinking that it's a long time, so why are we not reading about it? Because the extent of the empire is not something very big, is not something that, you know, even equivalent to what Mughal empire was. So hence we are not reading that much about Khandesh until and unless you belong to that particular state. Okay, so here also there you might find the names of Malik Raja Farooqi, who was the founder of this Farooqi kingdom of Khandesh, and then Nasir Khan, Adil Khan, Mubarak Khan. Okay, so I would say these are not important until you are from that state and you have to give that state's civil services examination. Then comes the Sultanate of Makalwa and the independence of Sultan Shibauddin Ghori and then Sultan Mahmud Ghori. So here also you might have seen that these are not mentioned in any other world chart, but we have just included so that you know that something like this existed. Then the most important empire that you should study even for your UPSC prelims and mains, because in mains also you will find there was a question about the Krishnadev Raya, okay, and not about his military conquest or something, but about how he was an able administrator and also a person who was very, you can say, good in literary works, because he himself has written many, many books, okay. So this was a question asked in mains, and to know or to even attempt this question, you need to have very, very specific information about what books Krishnadev Raya wrote, how he managed to actually create this vast empire called as the Vijayanagara Empire. Okay, so the empire of Vijayanagara, you can say, was founded in 1336, which is pretty early, which is the time when North India has Delhi Sultanate. Okay, and the two names that you should remember who actually are associated with the foundation of the empire are Harihara and Bukka. Can you repeat it with me? Harihara and Bukka. In 1336 to 1485, you will realize that the first dynasty of Vijayanagara, which was called as the Sangam dynasty, that was established. So just like in Delhi Sultanate, we had like five dynasties. We had slave, then we have Khiljis, then we have Tughlaqs, then we have Sayyids, and finally we have Lodhis. Similarly, Vijayanagara Empire is a big empire, okay. In that you have four dynasties which will be ruling one after other. One is Sangam dynasty, okay, then there is Saluva, then there is Tuluva dynasty, and finally you will find there is Aravidu dynasty. Okay, Sangam, Suluva, Tuluva and Aravidu. I know the names might not sound that familiar, but you have to learn. Okay, so it is a Sangam dynasty to which Harihara and Bukka belong, and it is the Tuluva dynasty to which Krishnadev Raya belong. Okay, so these two information that you should remember. So the first dynasty of Vijayanagara is called as the Sangam dynasty, as I told you here, and the annexation of Goa and Konkan to the empire of Vijayanagara happens in 1380. And now this time period is much before then when Portuguese are invading and they are capturing Goa. So Portuguese come later, but Vijayanagara has started much earlier. Okay, then comes the Dev Raya and Dev Raya II, and who were also the great kings of the Sangam dynasty. After Sangam dynasty, in 1486 starts the second dynasty or second empire of Vijayanagara, which we called as the Saluva dynasty. Okay, and this was started by the Saluva Narasimha, and that is why you can say the name itself suggests the name of the dynasty. Then after this, the third dynasty of Vijayanagara starts, which is basically the Tuluva dynasty, and which is started by the Veer Narasimha. Okay, and it starts somewhere around 1506 AD. And here you will find the second ruler, like after Veer Narasimha, was the Krishnadev Raya, who was a great ruler of this time. And he's the greatest ruler of Vijayanagara, if you can actually call him. Okay, and here you will realize that there are many battles being fought And finally, you will find that Vijayanagar Empire after Thuluva dynasty is getting weak, and some of the territories are now getting accumulated with the other empires, like small, small states which are present above or below in the sides of the Vijayanagar Empire. So here you can see that after, after Krishnadev Raya is the Sadasiv Rai, and in his regent you will find that there were many battles fought. And after the death of Rama Raj, basically Vijayanagar government has become very weak. And then it is transferred to the Golconda. Okay, and finally you will find that in 1570 you have Aravidu dynasty, which was founded by the Tirumala. So these are just few snippets that I'm giving you, but I'm telling you again and again that this is not the entire course of medieval India. This is just to be taken as a timeline. For covering the entire course, we have released another course, and by the name of Medieval India. Please go and watch it. It's there in the class 11th Tamil Nadu book also. And apart from that, there will be another course that will be covering the entire history via maps. So that will come later. But right now, we have started with Tamil Nadu class 11th and class 12th. After Vijayanagar Empire, the one kingdom that you also should study will be the Bahamani Kingdom. Now, Bahamani Kingdom is, I would say that this is an important kingdom. A, because UPSC has not asked questions on it as of now. And secondly, there are a lot of questions that can be asked. So, in both the perspective, it becomes important. Now, 1347 AD is the foundation of Bahamani Kingdom. And please remember the name of the emperor who started it. It's by the Alauddin Hasan Shah Al-Wali Al-Bahamani. Okay, it's easy to remember Bahamani. So that is how even I remember it. And his rule is there for almost about 10 to 11 years, from 1347 to 1358 AD. Now, you will realize that the Bahamani Kingdom had the capital as Gulbarga. Okay. And here you will find that Sultan Firoz Shah then becomes the second most important ruler. Then you will find comes the next phase where Sultan Ahmad Shah has become the ruler of the Bahamani Kingdom, and he has now shifted the capital to Bidar. Okay. Then after him also you will find that there will be another person who will become the ruler, and then there will be conquest of Goa and Belgaum from Vijayanagar, and then there will be execution of this Mahmud Kaman. Okay, and finally you will realize, see, Bahamani Kingdom is actually, if you want to call it, you can call it as a conglomerate of five kingdoms, five different successor sultanates, okay, which is Bidar, Berar, Khandesh, Golconda and Ahmednagar. Okay, so all these states, okay, once Bahamani Kingdom actually becomes weak, then these five successor states actually come into existence. So that is what I'm saying. This is why I say that Bahamani Kingdom actually becomes important. Because questions can be asked, but they have not been asked yet. Then you will discuss about the Bahamani successor states, what I just told you. Okay, so there is one of Ahmednagar that I told you, and that is a Nizam Shahi dynasty. Okay, so we are discussing Bahamani Kingdom and the successor states after its break. So first is the Ahmednagar, where Nizam Shahi dynasty is ruling. Okay, which is founded by Malik Ahmed Bari. And you don't need to remember that he was annexed by Shahjahan in 1637. Okay, then there is an Adil Shahi dynasty of Bijapur, which was founded by Yusuf Adil Khan. And now this Adil Shahi dynasty is important. You know why? Because from the art and culture perspective. So now you need to tell me in the comment box that why is this Adil Shahi dynasty famous for? Like, what sort of architecture did they introduce? Okay, and again you will remember that Adil Shahi dynasty was annexed by Shahjahan's son Aurangzeb. Okay. Then you have basically in Bijapur, Imad Shahi dynasty, which came later by and it was founded by Fatu Allah. And then this Fatu Allah like founded this Bijapur dynasty of Imad Shahi, and it got merged with Ahmednagar. Then came the Barid Shahi dynasty of Bidar, and this was founded by Amir Ali Barid. Okay. And then this Bidar dynasty actually gets merged with the Bijapur. Okay. So this Bijapur, and then Bijapur itself is getting merged with Ahmednagar. And then comes the last, which is the Qutub Shahi dynasty of Golconda, which was founded by the Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah. So now you can remember the name of Qutub Shahi. It's Muhammad Quli Qutub Shah who actually founded the Qutub Shahi dynasty. And he was the one who constructed a new capital at Hyderabad. Okay. And he was also annexed by Aurangzeb. So I hope that you have been clear with the Bahamani successor states also. And here at this time, since I told you that Europeans have started coming into India, so what we have done is we have taken at least those Europeans which are already there in India. So as you know that it was actually, see, why did the European come to India? Or like, you know, why only Portuguese came? Where are like Britishers who ruled us for so many long years? Like, where are they at this point of time? So you will realize actually there was King Henry. Okay. एंड ही वॉज द वन हु एक्चुअली यू नो यू कैन से गॉट अ ट्रीटी बिटवीन स्पेन एंड पोर्टुगल. सो इफ यू नो द वर्ल्ड मैप यू विल फाइंड दैट देर इज स्पेन एंड देन देर इज पोर्टुगल समवेयर लाइक दिस. ओके दिस इज पोर्टुगल. सो इन देर वॉज अ ट्रीटी बिटवीन स्पेन एंड पोर्टुगल दैट बोथ आर गोइंग टू एक्सप्लोर द वर्ल्ड बिकॉज लाइक देर इज अ डिस्कवरी ऑफ कंपस एंड ऑल एंड नाउ यू कैन एक्चुअली लोकेट द पोजिशंस करेक्टली. And Portuguese is going to travel in the east and Spain is going to travel in the west. And they have divided the whole world in a basically by a line, this midline. And every territory line to the east will be discovered by Portuguese and every territory line to the west, okay, will be discovered by the Spain. And west and east is according to me, okay, according to my direction, not the direction of the book. So here you will realize that is why you will realize that it was the Spanish people who actually discovered the American colonies, but it was the Portuguese who discovered India. Okay, so Vasco da Gama came to India in 1498 and you must know that he was helped by a Gujarati trader. Okay, otherwise what was happening? See, this is Spain, this is Portugal and this is Europe. Okay, here is somewhere Africa and then from here you reach this Arabian Peninsula and then after this Arabian Peninsula there will be Iran and then there will be Pakistan, Afghanistan and finally there will be India. So now if you have to reach India via sea route, okay, so basically they have crossed Mediterranean Sea and now what is happening? They are basically going across this African nations, okay, and this is the Cape of Good Hope, okay, and here they will pick up basically a Gujarati trader who will show them the way to actually go till Gujarat because he is from Gujarat, so he can show the way to Gujarat from Africa and now basically this is how Vasco da Gama reaches India. So the Vasco da Gama basically is a Portuguese, you can say ambassador and he reaches India in 1498 AD. And where does he arrive? He arrives at Calicut. Okay, and he's actually, you know, celebrated by the Zamorin of Calicut who basically welcomes him because he's also like shocked to see that there are other people who are visiting now his particular state or city or country. Now there is 1500, you will realize that there was a Portuguese fleet under Cabral which reaches Calicut again. And then Vasco da Gama comes again for a second voyage to India. Okay, here you will realize just like when we study modern Indian history, you will realize that Britishers had a governor system, okay, wherein they are giving the territory of India and putting it under some governor, a person who can actually manage the affairs. Similarly, Portuguese also had this governor system or viceroy system. The first viceroy of Portuguese side was this Jamorim de Almeida, okay, then second was this Albuquerque. And then the third governor general, which is not mentioned here, just please write it. It is Cuno. Okay. So I'm not writing his full name, but it is Cuno. So this is Almeida, Albuquerque, and Cuno. So these are the three Portugal viceroys that you can say, which actually came to India and which managed the affairs in India. Okay. Here are the timelines given for different viceroys, which you can see. So Almeida is the viceroy from 1505 to 1509. Then between 9 to 15 is Albuquerque. Okay, and you will find that each of these viceroys is actually coming up with a new type of policy. Okay, either like for example, Almeida gets into battle of Chowth. Okay, then you will find that Albuquerque is the one who is introducing one different kind of policy in India. And then finally, you will find that Albuquerque was the one who actually won Goa from Adil Shahi Sultan, which we just studied, but he does not make Goa as his capital. It is the third viceroy, Cuno, he shifted his capital to Goa from Cochin. Because actually what is happening, Portuguese have come to India, they have landed in Calicut, okay, but they have made their capital as Cochin. And from Cochin now, because of the third viceroy Portuguese, the capital gets shifted to Goa. Okay, so that is why I'm saying, please remember, it was not the same person who conquested Goa and shifted the capital. It is just like, similarly, what we studied during the Haryanika dynasty in ancient Indian history, wherein we studied that it was, that Ajatasatru was not the one who actually made Pataliputra as the capital, but he only conquested it, or he only realized the importance of it, and it was only his successor that made Pataliputra as the capital. Something like that is again happening here. Okay, history is repeating itself. And here then you will find that 1511, finally the headquarters have been shifted to Goa. And that is why in India, there is a, you know, state called as mini Portuguese or Portugal, which is basically Goa. Because here you will find that still there are many elements of Portuguese culture that are present and vividly seen in the scene if you visit Goa. So with this, we actually finished the Delhi Sultanate. The here and there fringe kingdoms, as you can say, provincial kingdoms of Khandesh, Gujarat, Makalwa, Vijayanagar Empire, and also successor states of Bahamani Kingdom, And along with that, we also covered the Portuguese. Okay, in the next one, we will study with the Mughal Empire. But before that, before we can start with the Mughal Empire, we will actually study about the Great Marathas. Okay?